So through Uncle Bob and Auntie Berta, and you know, I hope it was on part of the worship team, right? And you know, thank you guys for doing worship. Praise God that you guys ran into the community. I heard there was some little glitches going on. But you power. And then I want to say thank you to Paul. I heard it was a great message. I tried to look on the thing. I am not very equipped. I went to old messages, but Kihau found it. Everybody loved it. It was a great message from what I heard. We had a great mini church off of that message. So thank you guys. It's so awesome to know that there's enough people that love the Lord, that when there's business you got to take care of, the church of God still continues to run. So thank you guys all. I mean, everybody, you know, all you guys, you know, doing all the work we have to do. So thank you all of you guys. Today, we're going to do, well, when I, the reason I wanted to listen to Paul's message was because I wanted to know what he did in order that I could, you know, carry on. So I figured, okay, I think it's about here and I'll start here. Well, I started my study while we were out on the beach in Louisiana, chapter 4, verses 11 to 17. Then he goes, oh, Paul did it all. I was like, what? I'm freaking out because I'm already in go mode, you know, and I'm like ready to shoot this, and I'm like, okay, I have to pray. I said, Lord, do I continue and give a different perspective? I mean, that, and then I thought about it, or do I jump to chapter 5? And I felt that the Lord said, no, share a different perspective. Why? Because the Lord wants us to know that His Word is so great that it can speak in many different ways, depending on where our hearts are. You know, so the Word of God doesn't get dull. You know, it's amazing that I've been a Christian for a while. I've heard probably all the sermons you can probably hear. And every time I hear it, there's something that goes, like, I heard that, and then there's the other part goes, I can use that. And so I'm going to continue in chapter 4. I'm going to just add some frosting to the cake that Paul delivered last week. So the message title, Making Plans, James 4, verses 11 to 17. I think it's easy for believers to make plans and set goals in our lives, expecting God to fit in or fall in line with the plans we created. How many of you guys agree? Right? We're so good at making plans and then expect God to fall in place with our plans. Well, the crazy thing is that we don't think about it, but when we make plans like that, what we are seeing is that we are in control of our future. And we have unlimited authority over the factors that affect our future or our life. Right? There was something that happened this past week. In fact, just yesterday, we were talking to someone and they were sharing that your life is kind of difficult right now. And this person is a Christian, okay? And so the news this person got was really upsetting and caused this person to be hindered in their spirit and discouraged. And so I was talking to this person and I said, did you ever ask God what His will is for your life? And the person looked at me and goes, what? I go, did you ever ask God, as a believer, God, what is your will for my life? That person said, no. I wonder why you're in the situation you're at. Now that might seem very arrogant, but it is truthful. You know, one of the things I've learned, and I really believe that God has been doing a work on me, when I started working for the school system, I am still on a call. You know, if they need me, they call me. So if they don't need me, they don't call me. I mean, I don't know if they're making a dollar today or not. But since I asked God, and I left 49, so I said, Lord, if this is what you want for me, I'm going to take the step forward, and then I'm going to trust you to do the rest. And so I prayed about it. I felt like God says, take the move. And then I made the move, and then summer came. I didn't realize that summer, all the calling people, the ones that's on call, they don't work. It means you don't get paid. Well, I said, okay, Lord, that's kind of messed up. And when I started, they said, oh, you cannot have unemployment. So and I was like, what? This is like, that sucks. I mean, I've never had unemployment, like, I don't know. But I took it to God and prayed and said, Lord, you know, I really felt like you said make the move, so I'm going to make the move. But now I'm in another dilemma. I mean, you know, I thought you said make the move. Now am I not working? Am I not working? And there's no money. There's no money. I'm not very happy. You know, the bills keep rolling in, whether you get money or not. They don't care, right? And so this crazy thing happened this past summer. A lot of people were supposed to, permits were supposed to work, didn't show up. So they called me in. I got to work the whole summer. Right, and 8 hours. Oh, I was so happy. Right? Then came the school year. They said this and that. You still would be on call. But since school started, I've been working almost on a regular basis. And then summer came, this break, and they told me that I'm not going to be working. All the permanent workers are taking the position. And I was like, wow, that sucks. You know, but I was like, counting on, you know, one of the things with the state that's very amazing, they have choke leave. And they can take off choke times and somehow not get fired. I really want to get hired by the state, you know. And so, these people are out for years on PDI and all this stuff, right? And I'm like, well, you know, I feel bad for them, but praise God, because they're out means I work, you know. And so summer came and all the permanents wanted to work, and I told God, I said, I guess I'm not working. Yeah, I was happy. Because the honeydew list starts coming out, right? But you don't get paid for honeydew list, right? So I was like, oh Lord, if this is what I'm supposed to do, I'll do it. Then I was asking if I should go for unemployment. I said, you know, it's just 2 months and blah blah blah. And the Lord says, well, just try. If you qualify, you qualify. If not, then so I did the footwork, I find out that I qualified for unemployment. Now they were going to give me $300 a week. I was screaming like a girl. $300 a week to do nothing. And tell me if you're not going to do cartwheels. I was like, as fat as I am, I'm going to do a cartwheel right now. I was so happy. And then I said, yes, but thank you. Your will be done, right? And I'm like, yeah. Well, my aunt was over, we had our family reunion, a camp and all that stuff, and the day she goes home is Tuesday afternoon. Tuesday morning, I get a call from Nana Yukupona to come work for 4 hours. I was so angry. Because I wanted to say no. But if I'm right, if you say no, you lose your benefits, right? And so I was like, Lord, how do you want me to have an employment? Right? I mean, I really felt that, you know? And the Lord says, you said, whatever your will is for me. And I will you go back to work. And I was like, okay. So I went back to work and I've been working. I've been picked up by Nani Kupono School. I have like a choice schedule, 7 to 11:20. I work, but don't work. I really feel like a state worker, actually. No offense. Except you teachers. Well, yeah, I hope you know what it seems is. But I'm enjoying it. And one of the things that I've learned to have is peace in whatever God's decision for me. Regardless if I make plans. You know, actually, I want you to understand this. I've learned to make plans, ask God what He wants. How many of you guys do that? Make plans, you ask God what you want, and then you don't hear nothing. Yeah. You're like, I'm praying, answer me anytime. Right? But we're going to have some warnings from James today about not making plans with God's will in mind. how to be sure that we're hearing God. Okay? So, I think that once we understand what it means to give kingship to Jesus, it'll help us to deal with life a whole lot better. The book of James, again, is written to believers, written to you and I, the church. So I really love this because it tells me that there's some problems in the church that was going on that needed to be addressed. And the problem was people making plans but never asking God how the plan should unfold. So with this, let's look at what James will give us warning. And the warning is really against self-centered planning. Right? When we plan and it's all about self. You ever notice that when you plan, it's so self be happy? And you never plan so other people can be happy. I plan so me can be happy. Why? Because I love me. And me deserve it, right? And so, when it comes to the Bible, one of the basic teaching is that we go from me to them. And that's not very easy when we are brought up in a role that says it should be me. So, we all need to understand that worldly living is not only displayed by the disbelief in God, but it is also displayed in a disregard of planning without God. Okay? And we see this in the church a lot of the times. In fact, we're going to talk about a Jewish cult, a group of people in a little bit that loved the Lord. They were dedicated to the ways of the Lord. But when it came to planning, business planning, the Lord was not involved in that planning. So let's get ready to see what God has to say to us, because I want us to really get our hearts and our ears tied around this message, because the problem lies when we have a critical spirit. How many of you guys realize when you have a critical spirit, because you're angry that things didn't unfold the way you had it to happen? But you're not getting what you want. So as believers, we throw a tantrum. You guys ever saw believers throw a tantrum? I tell you, as a pastor, I see it all the time. And every now and then, I see myself in the mirror during my own tantrums. But the Lord will say to us that we need to be very careful to catch this, because it's all about a self-willed spirit instead of one that embraces the Spirit of God. In fact, if you can catch this, a bunch of your problems will disappear. Especially with the ones with the kids, the ones with your spouses, and the ones with your fellow co-workers. Okay, so let's look at what James has for us tonight. Chapter 4, verses 11 to 12. Don't speak evil against each other, dear brothers and sisters. If you criticize and judge each other, then you are criticizing and judging God's law. But your job is to obey the law, not to judge whether it applies to you. Now, I don't know how you guys feel about highlighting and marking your Bible, but you ought to mark that part right there where it says, but your job is to obey the law, not to judge whether it applies to you. See, that's one of our biggest problems. God alone, who gave the law, is the judge. He alone has the power to save or to destroy. So what right do you have to judge your neighbor? So our first warning is, be careful of being prejudiced. In verse 7 to 11, as Paul read for you guys last week, we are commanded to humble ourselves and to repent to God for an unclean heart. Right? When there's something in our heart that's not right, it's not godly, if there's something that's keeping us from being all that God wants us to be, whether it's unforgiveness, hatred, you know, dislike, whatever. The Bible says that we need to clean that out of our system, and we do that by confessing to the Lord. And when we confess to the Lord, what we do is we humble ourselves before God. All that action, all that emotions shows God that you worship Him. Unbelievable. I mean, you guys may think it's just nothing, but heaven rocks. The angels start shouting when we humble ourselves before God and heaven. Why? Because we have never set our eyes on God. And yet our faith causes us to bow before His throne and ask His authority and power to correct us and make us right. Right? I mean, I don't know about you, man. I just see angels just flipping that we give such a worship to God. And such a worship causes God to smile upon His children. Now, if we don't, right, start to humble ourselves, then we are in the danger of growing in us in stubborn pride. You ever notice that when you don't want to forgive somebody, how ugly you become? I ain't forgiving that. So what? They don't mean nothing to me. Right? But according to the Word of God, right? Now, keep in mind, I don't want you to think outside of the church. Okay? This is not outside of the church. This lesson is for the church. If we are talking speak about our brothers and sisters in Christ, then we are insulting God's wisdom and knowledge. Why? Because we're created in the likeness of God. But isn't it crazy that there is so much in-house fighting because of pride? And so the Lord says, you need to humble yourself. Because if you don't, then you will be stubborn in pride. And when you get stubborn and full of pride, you become blind and numb to the prompting of the Holy Spirit, which tells us that we're doing something wrong. Right? You ever notice that, oh, when you're really active in your relationship with God, the little things bother you. Things like, I thought this and it was wrong. Nobody knows. Nobody would know that you sin. Whether it's lusting, cussing, whatever in your brain, right, in your mind, nobody knows. But isn't it funny that a relationship with God causes you to feel bad that you even thought such a thing? And so you go, Lord, forgive my mindset that I was thinking this, and I know that's not worth it. Now, here's a very good clue that pride is starting to blind you and numb you to the Holy Spirit. So when you start thinking it, it no longer causes your heart to feel jump. Scientists call it your conscience. The Bible calls it the Spirit of God. So when the Spirit of God is no longer prompting us and tugging at us, right, because we did something wrong, and it is a great sign that we are in a self-preservation or self-will mode. The reason why the Holy Spirit prompts us is because the Holy Spirit has been offended. Does that make sense? So if the Holy Spirit is offended, and the Holy Spirit, according to the Scripture, right, is the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Each have their own function, but each, you know, is still one. So when I offend God, the Holy Spirit is offended, and the Holy Spirit is such a kind of heart, goes, that wasn't nice. So if you stop feeling that that wasn't nice anymore, you don't feel like that anymore, you are in great danger of walking away from the Lord, or even misbelieving this idea of being saved, and you're not. Does that make sense? You see, a lot of times we think, I wouldn't ask God in my life, so no, I saved. You know what they said, right? Long as you confess. If But you ought to read the whole scripture. It says, confess with your lips, your heart, your mind, and your whole being. That means I gave God kingship over my life. And His way is the only way. My way isn't the way. Now, I'm not saying that God doesn't want us to enjoy life. God wants us to enjoy life. It's created for us. But we have guidelines to keep us from falling off the path. Now, verse 11 prohibits belittling our brothers and our sisters in Christ. Once again, I mentioned because it's an insult to God. We're created in the image of God. Right? So, how many of you guys are parents? Okay? Raise your hand. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. I see you over there. So if I come to you, since Bette never like raise your hand, I'll use Bette as an example. And I told Bette that your daughter sucks, is ugly, is worthless. Do you think Bette is gonna say amen? I can almost guarantee you Mom will be able to come out and she will dig my eyeballs out. You talking about my child? Why? Because when I insult her child, I insult her. That is how it works with God. When I insult one of you, a child of God, I insult God and I tell God what He created is worthless. Therefore saying to Him, He's worthless. Now you kind of get the picture? That's kind of heavy duty stuff, right? So the Lord says, stop talking about each other in the church. Stop digging each other's eyes out, because when you guys are doing that, you guys are doing it to me, and I don't like it. Judging and criticizing others is always easier than judging ourselves. I think that's why we like to judge people. Why look at my problem and Kanani get so much more than me? Right? Or Vaughn, you know, she get one problem, but it's so huge, right? And my problems are not many, and they're very little problems. But Vaughn's one big problem. Oh, it stinks. Why? It's easier for me to point fingers at everybody than to evaluate and critique my own life. You know, somehow, to see Yolanda and all her problems make me feel good and says, she needs more Jesus than me. And the minute I do that, guess what? I need more Jesus than she. And so the Lord is saying, you know what? Before you critique other people, critique your life. Because He's saying this because if we critique ourselves, we'll find that we have no right judging anybody else. In fact, that's what the law is talking about. And we'll talk about that in a little bit, okay? To speak against one another and to find harsh criticism and attack people behind their backs is too often a description of believers of the church. You notice that if you ask somebody why they're not in church, they'll say something like that. Oh, because, you know, they backstabbers. Oh, they all gossip, you know? And that is very sad. Now here's the thing. We're no different from the outside. We still deal with, you know, attitudes. Yeah? We still have issues. The difference between the world and the church is that we have found salvation in Jesus Christ. What keeps us the same as the world is if we don't work at salvation and produce fruit of a believer in Christ. And that's why I really, you know, I never saw the book of James the way I see it now. I mean, it's really one that just tells us believers, wake up, get your life together. You know, stop acting like the world. So, I've seen many people walk away from the Lord because of gossip, because of ill things, you know, and one of the things that I was, thinking about, and it came out in one of our discussions at work, that we are in a generation where people don't talk anymore. right? The text. The Facebook. Facebook is the work of the devil, okay? That's just my opinion. Because what I see on Facebook is somebody who wants to complain and say things that don't have the guts to go and resolve it with the person. Instead, blast it all over the world to see and create a whole commotion that just really is unnecessary. Okay, that's just my opinion. So you might see me with a Facebook account. Don't send anything to me. I only got that because I wanted to play the game. And then when I really got into the game, the Lord says, that is not good for you. I was so angry with God because I really got into the game. So I stopped going on Facebook to play these games. So if you're sending me something and not replying, I'm not being stuck up. I don't need it. Okay? Well, I want us to understand this, that if there's an issue, we need to speak to each other. It is not necessarily going to come out when you want it to come out. But when we come and speak with the heart of God to resolve His household, right? Something crazy happened. So back to what I was saying. I almost got sidetracked because I'm stupid Facebook. Okay? There's something that we used to do as children. We were brought up doing it constantly, and especially every New Year's. We would get together every New Year's before the New Year comes and apologize to everyone that's in the circle for any wrong that we have done. And if there is something against a certain person, we know we would address that person. But we wouldn't say, because you did this to me, that's why I did this, so I wanted to ask you about it. No, it was like, I want to apologize for my actions and my words. If I caused any pain, any hurt, any reason for you to not love me, want to love me and this family, then forgive me. And once we were done, guess what? It was never brought up to them. It's so wonderful. I think they got this concept from the Bible. The Bible says, confess your sins to the Lord, and I will remove it as far as the east is from the west. Never again to meet up. That means never again to be brought up. And that was the wonderful work of Ho'oponopono. And we don't do that today. And it is a very wonderful skill, if you would, to put back into the family unit and practice. Even the church. We take ownership of our actions, and that's it. We say sorry, and then we let it go. Now, when we have this critical spirit and we don't want to let anyone in, we get this prideful mindset that comes on. What we really are doing is allowing ourselves to make plans for ourselves, not involved in anything that God wants for us. The Bible says that Jesus came to give life and to give it abundantly, right? John 10:10. It also says in that same chapter that we need to be careful because the enemy is out there and he wants to steal life. He wants to steal joy. So we need to use wisdom. That the devil is not going to sit down and look at God's church and go, great job, look how they're loving on each other. No. He's going to say, you know what? Too much love. Let's stir something up. And the devil can only creep in when a person's heart is not connected to God in worship. Why? Because, granted, we have to understand this. We are always going to get hurt by somebody's words. Have anybody here not been hurt by somebody's words? Yeah. Because if you did, God bless you. Because I've been hurt many times by words. And not all the time it was intentional. A lot of times it was just something that somebody said, it went here, it went here, it went here, and somehow got twisted and was said different, and all of a sudden I was like, oh yeah, Right? You guys ever had any of those? Well, in fact, we just had one last night. I'm not going to mention names or anything, but the thing went like this, and then it goes, oh, this was said, and the other person says, oh yeah. So just humble yourself, let it go, you're just talking. Then on, we talk, talking, we find out that half the story that was told never happened. We are nasty, right? Why? Because we like gossiping too, right? We like eating the fire of God's little gossip. That's why we need the power of Jesus. But sometimes we have to come out, be quiet. Yeah? Then we just gotta shut up. So, to have a critical spirit again is really a plan of having a self-will, not involved in God's will. Our second warning is tomorrow's plans is not always promised. Now James 4 verses 13 to 14 says, look here, you who say, today or tomorrow we are going to a certain town and we'll stay there and here. We will do business there and make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, then it's gone. Now, here James presents us with three negative responses and one positive to how people respond to the will of God. The first negative response came from this group of men who planned a business trip to make some money, okay? And I want you to understand, it's not wrong to plan and make some money. You know what I mean? That's a good thing. Again, the problem is that these men that James is speaking of is men who are Jewish men, right? Men who claim to be in love with the Lord, men of the church, okay? But yet, when they plan without asking God what they should do. So it's all about making money. Okay? So, these believers are making plans and never asking God what He wants us to do. How many of you guys wake up in the morning and goes, Lord, good morning, I love you, I bless you. So, how do you want us to take today on? You know, I'm no offense, but you are a child of God. You submitted to God. Therefore, saying to the Lord, your ways all the way. Yet when we wake up in the morning, we don't give Him any opportunity to lead us. Right? So, they love the Lord, and yet they fail to do exactly what love means. There was words and no action. Okay, there's a word, and I hope I say this right. Diaspora, it was a group of Jewish people that was just all around the world. When Babylonians came and they captured the Jewish people, one of the things is you guys should know is that there's still a lot of Jewish people all over the world, and they're making a migration back to the Holy Land, as Scripture is saying. Well, one of the things that happened when these people all scattered, these Jewish people, and if you guys know them, they're very money-oriented, they're very smart. And so, whatever would happen is when there was opportunities to make money on the outside, they were able to get these connections so that they know, hey, there's a chance of a profit here and all this stuff. And so, if you notice, the Jewish community is very, very business-oriented. You know, they just are very smart in that way. But the problem was, although a bunch of these Jewish people were very strong believers in God's existence, they lived as if God didn't exist, meaning they didn't plan with God's heart in mind for them. Now, here's the little catch that I'm thinking. Very much so like us today, who wake up in the morning and never ask God, how should we tackle this need? How many of you guys would agree that because you're in love with the Lord and you respect the Lord and you honor Him? Raise your hands. Okay. Now, same question I asked earlier. How many of you wake up every morning and say, Lord, you need me. Your will be done. You have a problem, Houston. Right? You see, and it's not to point out how much flaws we have, but I want us to see this. Maybe our lives, you think, might be a little bit better if we start asking God, so what am I supposed to do today? Well, I definitely know that I woke up for a reason. That reason is to bring glory to His name. But how am I supposed to do it? Lord, when I go to work, is there somebody bothering you at work and you cannot stand and take the eyes out? In fact, you can't stand them, period. I have one at work right now. Not right now. When the school comes back, I'm not going to say the person's name because that makes me all angry. And when I see this person, I just like to tell this person that hell is a wonderful place waiting for him. Oh, I just told you we're in that area. But I got to really behave. Right? And so I ask, every morning I pray, Lord, when I go to work, help me to deal with this person. Help me not to judge him and see him the way I see him, but help me to see him according to your eyes and your heart. And, you know, that's hard to see, right? But I want you guys to always remember this. The pain that Jesus suffered on Calvary was because the heart of God for His people. John 2:16 tells us, for all people, right? Not just for some, not just for the nice ones, even the ugly, mean, oh, that one. So as much as personally my will is tell the person off, even plot to get that person fired somehow. You guys ever plot it sometimes? Yeah. I'm a pastor. I'm so need Jesus, but I plot a lot sometimes. But I gotta ask God to help me to remove that and, you know, just get free from that, because I know the will of God is for that person to find salvation. But how can that person find salvation when I'm supposed to be the reflection of Jesus, but I reflect the likeness of Satan more than the God I serve? Does that make sense? You know, I'm not saying you're not going to have problems and you're not going to have issues, but I want to say this. Sometimes God will remove things from our life in order that we will be able to see better what He's trying to say. And sometimes when those things are removed, it brings hardship in our life. But only when those hardships come, I'll be able to bow before God and recognize His kingship. It was only when I was in a position where I'm like, okay, babe, we got no money coming in. I don't know what we're going to do. The mortgage rolling in, the utilities rolling in, all this stuff rolling in. And I don't know what to do anymore. I'm 51 years old, but you saw this guy, I was crying like I was 10 years old. I was like, I don't know what to do, you know, stuff. And finally, I went to the Bible, and I just felt like the Lord says, you have to trust me. But I don't know how to trust him, because I cannot see him. I mean, don't get me wrong, and I read the stuff in here, it's awesome. But my life sucks right now. And the Lord says, you can trust me through this time. You will be amazed at what I will reveal to you. Today, because of what God has done in my life, and because of the people that God has placed in my life that love Him, I'm at a place that if God doesn't do a miracle today, I'm sold out of a leader. I don't ever have to be healed again with anything. I don't even have to see any more blessings. I'm sold out that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And because of this mindset, it's like, you know, Lord, I don't need to see anything. I believe. And it's like the Lord says, now I can bless you even more because your heart is a heart of worship. And I'm not rich. I'm not any place better off than I was before, but I have a spiritual richness in me. And regardless of what my life is looking like, regardless of what this world is looking like, I am confident that everything is going to be okay. Crazy, crazy peace that only God can give. Even in the peace of when someone passes or there's something bad going on, I mean, I see that I just got to let God be God, and there's something great that's going to happen. I may not understand it all, but I'm confident that the God I serve is a God who keeps His word. Therefore, although I may not see the whole picture, the ending of this whole picture is a glorious victory. Crazy, crazy stuff. So, I think it's safe to say that what we are being told is that we cannot brag about tomorrow. And when we brag, how do we brag about tomorrow? We act like we get tomorrow coming. Oh yeah, go to church tomorrow. Read my Bible tomorrow, right? I'm going to do this tomorrow, but tomorrow comes. Half of the time we don't do it because we'll say we'll do it again tomorrow, right? But what happens if you don't wake up tomorrow? I was meeting up with different people who had made promises or goals to finish projects. Raphael, a painter, he had started this painting, and they're saying in this thing I was reading that his decision was, he was tired, he said, I'm going to do this tomorrow. He never woke up. And so at his funeral, he brought the half-painted picture at his funeral and displayed it. You know, I don't know what the purpose was, but that would really suck, you know, because it kind of says that, you know, spirit went weakening, you know. I might die tomorrow, you know what I mean? You know, when people talk about death, we all get scared, you know. But we don't have to be afraid that we have Jesus. But what I believe God is saying to us in Scripture is that, you know what, let's make the best of today. We be the best Christian we can today. And worry about tomorrow and tomorrow come. Right? Oh, in 1 year, I'm going to be the best leader in the whole church. Should I just be the best leader today? Because tomorrow you might not be here to be a leader. But be the best for Jesus today. And if we are granted tomorrow, then we be the best leader tomorrow. Does that make sense? So we have no boasting to do. You know, and this is usually a lesson learned when people are struck with disaster, right? And they're at that life or death situation, and they come to you and go, man, I'm not taking life for granted. But we don't have to wait for that. We can start living that way for Jesus today. Proverbs 27:1, don't brag about tomorrow since you don't know what the day will bring. Now, there was an article I found some on this sermon.net, sermon.com, yeah. And they were writing about this group of wealthy men in 1923. And they came together and they had a meeting to discuss their future. Very wealthy people. And I started to read about this stuff, and I found out that, you know, they had this article that after 20 years, some crazy things happened. Wealthy guys, okay? Now listen to this. 20 years later, three died from suicide, two died bankrupt, two was in prison, and one was actually let out to die at home, and then one went insane. They had this great plan for their future, and it ended up in disaster. I wonder what the outcome would have been if God would have been part of that plan. We don't have to be wealthy people financially to make plans with God. Like I said, Lord, how do you want me to bless my family? How do you want me to behave? Right? You know, do you want me to go get a whole one of one right now with them? Even though I don't want to, do you want me to do that? Right? Now, in Luke 12, Jesus tells a parable of a rich fool. I'll read it real quickly. It says, and he told them a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, what should I do? I don't have room for all my crops. Then he said, I know. I'll tear down my barn and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you work for? Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God. You know what makes us wealthy? It's this relationship with God. I don't know how we're going to pay that bill, Lord, but I trust that somehow you're going to make it happen. I don't know about you, but there's this time that God just does stuff that's really uncomfortable for me. A lot of times, He show up 1 minute before the deadline. To me, that's late. And the Lord says, no, no, I'm just showing you that I am perfect. Be on time. I told you I can be careful. He's not holding up out so that he goes, yeah. Watch him waver in the faith. He's saying, no, watch my child. Trust me to the very last second. There's something that I really hang on to in the Bible. He says that as believers, we have to pray about everything. Right? All the time. And then when we ask God something, we have to pray until we get an answer. But isn't it true that if we don't get an answer in 1 day, maybe 2 days, we'll change the prayer around? Right? We try to make it an easier prayer for God to answer. God doesn't have a problem in answering. We have a problem if we stay fast in our faith about God and His capabilities. See, that's the difference of planning with God and without God. We need to get this down. Now, verse 14 points out two things. One, we don't know if we will have tomorrow, so don't plan for tomorrow in the sense, I mean, don't be so bold for that. You know what? I'm going to take care of my ho'oponopono tomorrow. I'm going to make right tomorrow. I'm going to go to church, but no. If church is today, you can't get church today. Right? Because tomorrow, God may call you to do something else. But in case you don't wake up, guess what? It's too late to business. This is, the second thing is that we're here only for a moment. Yeah? It says like a vapor in the scripture. The one we read is just the morning. Well, in scripture, I'm going to jump a little bit in 17, it says that it is sin to know what you ought to do and don't do it. Right? So it's sin to know that God taught your heart today to take His stuff today and then put it off for tomorrow. That's what He's saying. You know what needs to be taken care of, or you take care of it. But a lot of times we hold back because we're hoping that they don't make the first move. Right? And then if they don't make the first move, we're hoping the second thing happens. That I feel okay with it. That it's not bothering me. And a lot of times we can sabotage ourselves by believing that everything's okay. And then when we see that person again and they so happen to roll their eyes because something will happen behind you, we want to fight because we never take care of it. We're still mad inside. We just kind of covering up so we don't do what we should do. It is sinful to take care of what you should and you don't. Does that make sense? Okay, we get it down to the end. Now, let's look at this last point here, it says in 15 to 17. The warning is we need to have a proper perspective of tomorrow. Now, what you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we will live, will live and do this or that. Otherwise, we are boasting about our own intentions and plans, and all such boasting is evil. Remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do, and then don't do it. So, verse 15 is saying that it's foolish to be not out of plan, which he was talking about, right? And when we leave God out of hands, then we're not worshiping Him as we said we would. Now, here's something you ought to know. When we submit to the kingship, it means that we, a person, is seeking the will of God and is eager to obey all of His plans or His heart, no matter what it costs us. You ever notice to serve the Lord? What makes it hard to be a Christian? Is it listening and doing, coming to church as much as it is when we're called to make correction with people? Yeah, when we're called to die to self, that's the hardest part. Yeah, prayer about your anger. Why? I deserve to be angry. It's rough, right? Whatever we do. But the lesson, when you gave your heart to me, you allowed me to be king, then you said to me that it was going to be my way, all the way. That regardless if people would come against me, we trust what the word says. What does the word say? No weapon formed against me and prosper. Right? One of my favorite scriptures on, I got my license, it's Isaiah. Only one thing, right? My Lord loves me so much. He holds me in His victorious right hand. And there's nothing that can happen. God was looking at me because that was His, and I stole it from Him because it fit me. It's important for us to hear and hang on to Scripture's truth. So how do we know the will of God? We need to read our Bible then. We need to pray. You study everybody in your life, right? You know what I mean? I'll pick on Jaylen because she's here today. At work, I can almost guarantee you know all the personalities and you know how each person will respond and what they're going to do, what they're going to talk about, right? The reason you know that is you spend hours watching them side by side, right? Walking past you, yeah. I can guarantee you she can walk past me 50 times before school, the first before she get on the dance, right? And so the Bible is, the Lord is saying, well, in order for you to understand me, you need to put that much energy into my word. Read about me. Understand my heart. You see, I don't think we really thought about offending one person and insulting God in such a degree that we dishonor Him as God. I don't think that would be any of our intentions. I know the mighty hand of God and what He's capable of. The last thing I want to do is insult Him or get on His bad side. Right? But isn't it funny that because we don't understand His heart, that we never think about criticizing and insulting another sister or brother in Christ as an insult and sinful action against God that causes God to be hurt? That alone should change the way we think and talk about each other, right? How did we learn that? We read the Word of God. God said, I don't like that. That sucks. That's not my intention. So the will of God becomes very obvious when we start reading the Word. The will of God is that we would be kind, gentle, soft-spoken. Not a word, man. God never said, oh, just go ahead and slap, 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 slap. He goes, no. You are children of the Most High God, or priests of the kingdom. And you don't submit to those authorities, I just say to my approach. I don't care what man sees. You hear what I see. And then you behave that way. You see, that's the crazy thing. You know that when you obey to God, you will not be able to contain the blessings that are in heaven. And granted that sometimes, you know, you might have hardship. I want you to understand that God loves you too much to allow you to stay at the same level of faith. He will constantly increase us. Because you are at 95 degrees of faith, whatever, or height, whatever, points. But I want you to get to 96 tomorrow, or next year, 97. In order to get a little bit higher faith, guess what? You have to go to some tests and some trials. But if God is the God who He say He is, and victory is mine, come next year, as He has scheduled, I will be at 97%. Why? Because it doesn't matter what happens in my life from now to next year. My eyes is focused on the goal. And that goal is the kingdom. Because I am focused on the kingdom, my heart is that of worship. You see, our action to obey is a sign of great worship to God. Pretty simple stuff. The problem is we make it difficult. Why do we make it difficult? We are prideful. If it's about the kingdom, we told God that we were sold out. But if God says you gotta say sorry, guess what? We'll say sorry. If it hurts, awesome. God was teaching you something here. How to be humble in His presence. How many of you guys love the Lord? Okay. I want us to see this because, you know, James is writing to us because he says, you know what? The believer is supposed to be a sore eye to the world, and yet we are failing to be such a representation of the world. Why? We have to work on the heart submitting to God's will. Allowing God to be part of our plans. See, one of the things, and I'll close with this, my pastor taught me, Pastor Mel, when I first got becoming a pastor, he gave me an organizer, a banner thing. And he told me to write things in pencil. I'm a pen person, right? Never write in pencil, a pen. Always write in pencil in case you gotta erase it or change it. I want you to take this to heart. I want you to plan your life. God wants us to plan our life. But I want you to write that pants in pencil and then give God the eraser to erase anything that He wants to change along the way. And you will be blessed with what He has for you. Amen? Let's pray.